Ah, yes. Doc Swinson's Whiskey presents Baseball Things.
Swung on and hit high and deep. That's out to center field. Greer's going back. Turns
around.
Pitch
is swung on and drilled high and deep down the left field line. If it stays fair, it's out of here.
Swing, line drive. This game is over.
Here's Jason A. Churchill.
Now we are talking. Things are starting to happen just a little bit, and I think we're going to get a few significant free agent signings or significant trades in the next week or so, especially if a club outside the usual suspects wants to make a splash. I think the longer they wait, the pricier it gets. And I'm talking about big-time free agents. I'm talking about Trevor Bauer. I'm talking about DJ LeMahieu. I'm talking about trading a guy like Trevor Story or Nolan Arenado or Francisco Lindor. If you're a mid-market or a small-market club, the longer you wait, the more expensive it gets, unless you want to wait till February or March and hope that player is still, you know, kind of being dangled out there because the club didn't get the offer they wanted, or if it's a free agent, the offer just didn't come in the way that they want and still just hanging and hoping. I think we're going to see one or two relatively large splashes in the next week to 10 days. I really do. I think the non-tender deadline having passed now, the market is as full as it's going to get. Teams know exactly what's going to get out there, and I think it's going to heat up just a bit as a result of that. Baseball Things, Jason Churchill. This episode is presented by Doc Swinson's Whiskey. As always, Doc Swinson's can take your holiday to the next level. Heck, it took my regular Tuesday to the next level. Try a Tennessee bourbon in a rum or sherry cask straight or mix it with a fizzer. I'm working on one right now from the flagship series as we speak. On the rocks, of course. Follow Doc on Instagram and Facebook to keep up on new releases. Doc Swinson's Whiskey, hand-selected for character and only bottled when ready. All right, here's what's on the agenda today. Lots of good stuff to get to. Which prospects are we going to see in Everett this year? I think it's a fun conversation to have. Nothing's been made official, but it appears the Northwest League clubs, the ones that remain, will become the Advanced A clubs, for including your Seattle Mariners, which makes it a lot of fun. So we'll talk about that. Could the Mariners benefit from all this roster fallout? There's a conversation to be had there. MLB expansion, question came in on that, so we'll touch on that again. Got a suggestion about John Means, the right-hander for the Baltimore Orioles, who's a pretty interesting arm. Interesting in some ways and risky in others. So that's a conversation that you could replace John Means with about 30 other guys, including the Mariners' own Yusei Kikuchi. They're very similar in a way, and we'll get to that in a little bit. How about robbing the Phillies? Can the Mariners go out there and take advantage of John Middleton crying poor? Maybe not. We'll get to that as well. This is another Thinger-fueled episode, of course. To get your questions on the podcast, head to bit.ly, that's bit.ly/AskBaseballThings. It's that simple. Leave your name or a Twitter ID under your question. I'd love a location, too. If you could put John from Snohomish or something like that, I love that. You certainly don't have to. That is entirely up to you. But I like it's always fun to know where folks are checking out the podcast from. You know, it just is. So you get your question, and you can ask as many questions as you like, by the way. I've had this question a lot about the questions. If you want to put five questions in one question or just put five different submissions in, totally fine with me. I don't care how you do it. I really, truly do not care how you do it. And if you're new to this podcast and you're listening only because it's free, because you're not sure it's worth it, this is the type of stuff we discuss every time out. And it is 90% driven by subscribers. We have entire episodes that are driven by subscriber questions. And that's it. Where I say little else on the pod or nothing else, I literally just answer questions. And that's a fun way for me to make sure that the listener is getting what it wants. It's hearing what it wants. You make it easy for me that way. And they're not just questions. It's not just Q&A. And I think that's the best part. These are ideas. These are hardcore baseball fans with legitimately really good ideas. The same kinds of ideas that baseball writers and podcasters come up with on their own. So we're kind of seeing things eye to eye here, and you might have ideas that I don't. And that's what I love about this. So if you're new to the podcast, this is it. This is how they this is how it goes. And we're going to get this underway. We're going to talk about the Philly situation. And it's a question that came in from Chris, who's at ZipKidCW on Twitter. Chris asked, hey, do you have any thoughts on the Phillies crying poor? Do they have any contracts we should help them out with? Nola, obviously, but should Jerry DePoto be touching base about players like Zach Wheeler, or should he steer clear of all the Phillies contracts besides Nola? What Chris is talking about here, in case you missed it, is the Phillies ownership coming out a little earlier in the week or over the weekend, can't remember which, claiming they lost $2 billion in 2020. The team losing $2 billion in 2020, suggesting perhaps that the Phillies look to cut some payroll for next season. What I think ends up happening here is the Phillies make several smaller cuts to payroll that impact 2021, but Wheeler, Aaron Nola, the right-hander, and Bryce Harper, I think they stay put. I really do. I think the 1 year and $23 million guaranteed left on Andrew McCutchen's contract, I think that's in play. I think Gene Segura is readily available. I think Philly owes Segura about $30 million guaranteed through 2022. I think some of their arbitration eligible arms could be trade available, including a guy like Vincent Velasquez and maybe even Zach Eflin. I've talked about Hector Neris a little bit. He's very interesting. He was a potential non-tender, and both he and Zach Eflin are really interesting for Seattle. Of course, Middleton lied when he said his club lost $2 million. Not even the Yankees or Dodgers even generate that much revenue in a full season. And operating costs never get anywhere near $1 billion. I think Middleton must think people, including those in his own organization, who he was talking to when that came out, I think he thinks that people don't know the difference between $1 million and $1 billion. Because that's absolutely insane to think that a club lost $2 billion. Did the industry lose $2 billion? Well, that's more like it. Did one team lose $2 billion? Absolutely not. And no team lost money. Let's get that straight. Teams do not lose. We didn't get to a point in 2020, even in a shortened season where there are only 60 games and no fans in the stands for those games, where a team had to go into, where an owner had to go into his own pocket and throw money out there to cover costs. That didn't happen. It didn't happen. Did they lose revenue? Yes. They lost revenue because there were only 60 games, not 162. There were no fans in the stands in most games. But they did make up some of that with a bigger playoff pool than ever before. And there were some markets where the television ratings were significantly higher because people couldn't go to games. So Middleton's just lying. He's a liar like most other owners. But yes, I think the Phillies are going to be open to a few things. The indication that Middleton gave with the whole payroll issue and the losing money thing was that big ticket free agents probably are not happening. Or, I mean, he may have flat out just said they're not happening, which means JT Realmuto is not coming back to the Phillies. But I think they're going to be open to some things. And I think the pandemic shortened season and the loss of revenue opportunities for clubs, which are legitimate, revenue losses are legitimate for 2020. Money losses are not. The value of the club still went up, didn't go down. The owner didn't jump into his own bank account to pay the accountants for the club. That kind of stuff didn't happen. But there are no indications that Phillies are going to kind of cut bait entirely. So I don't think Wheeler or Nola are going to be shopped. But I do think, you know, the Seguras and the McCutchens and maybe even a Zach Eflin, maybe certainly a Velasquez is available heading into it. And I think with the Realmuto situation, to be honest with you, I think any club that misses out on handing him 6 years or more and $25 million a year is dodging a bullet. And I've thought this for a long time. Realmuto is 30 years old and he's a catcher. The end. I'd love to have him for 3 years. I don't want him for 4, 5, and 6. Eflin, by the way, and I've mentioned Eflin before, he's going to be 27 in April, has 2 more years till free agency, had a very strong 2020, covered 59 innings and posted a 3.35 FIP and a 1.5 F4. He fits what the Mariners are looking for this offseason fairly well. He might be a little more expensive in trade than they're looking to make right now, but you would get him for 2 years. There's still some upside left there. He's not an automatic 200-inning guy. That's not what we're talking about. There are not a whole lot of those out there. But he's not likely to cost a top-five prospect either. That has to make it interesting for the Mariners and Mariners fans. Chris has another one on the Orioles, and this is the John Means conversation, but you think about the Baltimore Orioles, where the Baltimore Orioles are and where the Baltimore Orioles are trying to go and how far away they are. They're a bad team who had a decent start to 2020 and then faded like bad teams do, like the 2019 Mariners did. Peter Angelos, the Angelos family, have been known to spend money, and then cry poor for a while. And not really cry poor publicly, like we're losing money, but like then cut bait and start over. Kind of a mini Marlins type of scenario. And right now, you don't even hear the Orioles crying about that. And you don't even hear the Orioles saying anybody making money needs to go. Now, granted, they don't have a lot of guys making money, but they do have some arbitration eligible guys. And they're not out there like, nope, cut, cut, cut. If we're not winning, cut, cut, cut. We're not even hearing the Orioles do that. We're not hearing the Marlins do that. We're not even hearing right now the Pirates do that. And yet the Phillies, in one of the top, what, 8 markets in America, 10 markets in America, crying poor, crying $2 billion losses, crying and lying. It's just amazing. So, yeah, I think the Philly situation might present a few opportunities, just not as many of great impact, I don't think. One thing that I think is that might actually be interesting for not necessarily the Mariners, but clubs in general. When you think about the Philadelphia Phillies and if their owner, their managing partner, whatever you want to call him, John Middleton, wants to mitigate and kind of cut his losses in certain situations. No big ticket free agents. Let's see if we can move a McCutcheon for future help, things like that. Meaning maybe 2021, they're not so great, or at least the target, the focus isn't solely on 2021. Although if they're keeping Zach Wheeler and Aaron Nola, they should be focused on 2021. But think about a contract like Scott Kingery. He was a prospect they like, second base, center field. They gave him a 6-year, 24, but they gave him the Evan White deal back in right before the 2018 season. And while he's not making a whole lot right now, he made $1.2 million, I think, in 2019, $1.5 million in 2020. That jumps to $4 million in 2021, and then $6 million in 2022 and $8 million in 2023 before there are a couple of options that the team can get out of pretty easily with a $1 million buyout. Now, I bring up Kingery because you think about the kinds of players that Jerry DePoto likes as they move into season 3 of their rebuild. Well, Scott Kingery is 26 years old. He'll be 27 in April. He's never really done a whole lot. Okay, he hit 226, 267, 338 in his rookie season in 2018, which is right after he got the contract. And then in 2019, it looked like he was taking a pretty big step forward, hitting 258, 315, 474 with 19 home runs. And then last year in 36 games was terrible again. So I'm not saying his contract is a burden for the Phillies. I'm saying if Middleton is going to cry poor, that this might be the kind of contract that can be had, because he does get a little bit more expensive as we move forward. And the club has to think we might be giving, we might be paying $18 million over the next 3 years, $19 million over the next 3 years for a player that doesn't play every day for us. That's an expensive player. And that becomes an interesting conversation, at least in front offices. Hey, do we like Scott Kingery? Do we like what he brings to the table? Is he a legitimate second base option? Played 29 games at second base, 200 innings. Played a little third base in 2018 and 2019. Played a little center field in 2020. Played a lot more center field, 65 games in center field in 2019. That's a very interesting defensive profile, and certainly the ability is there. Now, he's a right-handed bat, so you can't grab him and hope he fills your left-handed hitter, you know, wants and needs. But I just thought that was an interesting thing when I was looking at through the Phillies roster, thinking about Chris's question, Scott Kingery came up. I don't know. Maybe nothing happens there, but it's something to think about. All right, moving on. Like I said, Chris has another question on the Orioles. Should the Mariners target John Means of the Orioles? The guy doesn't walk anyone, has a good fastball spin rate. He's 27 in pre-arbitration, so he's going to cost something real, but he's been successful as a starter and in the bullpen. Got any thoughts on Means or just any player on the Orioles that we should target in a trade because that player won't fit their window but would fit Seattle's? This is a good thought, Chris. Means is, what, 28 in April, not arbitration eligible, like Chris said, until after the 2021 season, and has better stuff than the results suggest. Like I said at the top, he's a little bit like Yusei Kikuchi in that way, and there are some guys out there like that, which always makes a starting pitcher more interesting than some of the numbers would suggest. Means is 93 to 96, average curveball, above average changeup, plus slider that just wasn't there for him much in 2020. Like Chris says, Baltimore isn't going to be all that motivated to move him because he's cheap, so the trade package itself is going to have to do that. But two things stand out for me about Means and his fit potentially in a place like Seattle. First and foremost, right now he's not a mid-rotation starter. You hope he gets there, but he hasn't proven that yet. And really what Seattle needs to add to their rotation right now, I mean, if you want to add Means as a second rotation add, great. But what you need in your rotation right now is basically another Marco Gonzalez. You need reliability. You need 175-plus innings. You need a guy who has a good track record of staying healthy, a guy that in a six-man rotation can give you 25 to 28 starts and give you mid-rotation production. 2.5 or better wins on a full in a full season. Now, Means has the stuff, and you know there's a chance that he gets to that point, but you can't be sure. You can't hit into it with a lot of confidence because he hasn't done it. And not only has he not done it once, he hasn't sustained it, and that's really what you want to see. I'd have a little more confidence in a guy like Jake Odorizzi because he's done it a few times. But there's some value to Means here at some level, and the Mariners, unfortunately, just need a little bit more impact and more reliability right now. As for Means in the bullpen, the problem here is the trade cost because you're paying for a starter. So while you believe it works in the pen, you acquire Means for a trade cost that suggests probably at least number four starter, but you're paying for all those control years, and then you throw them into the bullpen, you can do better. If you're acquiring John Means, you think he can start because that's the price you're going to be paying. I think, secondly, Means doesn't cost the big gun prospect either. Again, just like the Zach Eflin conversation, just like some of the other conversations with some of the other potential trade targets, that's important. Seattle has no business trading an Emerson Hancock or a Logan Gilbert or a Julio Rodriguez or a Jared Kelnick for anybody who's not elite. If you're telling me the Mets are trading Jacob deGrom or the Yankees are trading Garrett Cole or whatever, I mean, Cole with the contract might be a little tough, but you know, trading somebody who's elite. If Cleveland came to Seattle 3 years ago and said, "Hey, we're going to give you 4 years of control of Francisco Lindor, who's available," and the Mariners' farm system was then what it looks like now, everybody's available because you're getting an elite player, you're getting a star, and you're getting him for 4 years. So, you know, when you think about the Blake Snell deals and you think about any other big name player that might come up, how long are you getting him? And is he actually a star? This was a big part of our Blake Snell conversation because Blake Snell is not. Everybody thinks he is, but he's not. And if you missed that episode, it's literally called the Blake Snell episode, I think. Just head to Patreon and find it if you're not a subscriber. That one might be worth your $5 all by itself if you're really, really interested in the Blake Snell trade to Seattle and my explanation of why Blake Snell's not worth what he's likely to cost. And I have an idea of how to maybe fix that and land Blake Snell without giving up a top five prospect. That was a fun episode to do. But John Means is kind of one of those, you know, like it would make sense to get him just in a vacuum, but you're not really sure what he is. I do think Baltimore, by the way, has some interesting names to keep an eye on. if you're Seattle. And I mentioned one of them in my latest piece at Prospect Insider on Tuesday. Head to Prospect Insider. I believe it's still the top story. It's the one player from every team for the Mariners story. And I name a player from the Orioles in that story that makes a ton of sense for Seattle. One more from Chris before we move on to other thingers. Chris asks, hey, anyone left off the Rule 5 protection list interest you? What about one of the DFAs like Hunter Renfro, Trevor Williams, or Renato Nunez? Renato Nunez, Hunter Renfro, they don't really interest me at all because Renfro's an outfielder who needs volume to produce any value at the plate. He's a power guy, and you worry about the hit tool. That's why Tampa didn't tender him. That's why they DFA'd him before they even got to the non-tender situation. Nunez is really a first base, third base DH type, which is what Ty France is for the most part. So I think he kind of already have that player and probably a better player. So Nunez doesn't really interest me all that much. Williams is a little bit more interesting because he'd be uber cheap to pick up. But I think the upside here is fairly low as well. He's a four-pitch starter up to 93 as a below-average sinker, below-average changeup, below-average slider, average curveball. If you move him to the bullpen, maybe there's more velocity and one of those off-speed pitches ticks up. But the addition, you know, that kind of an addition is just it's really a project. It's really a flyer. And I'm not saying a minor league deal isn't worth it. I'm not sure a whole lot more is worth it at this point. It's certainly less interesting if you're moving him to the bullpen. Now, if you pick him up as a starter, again, he's just spaghetti for you because you're already entering the winter with Yusei Kikuchi, Justice Sheffield, Justin Dunn, and Marco Gonzalez, and we know Logan Gilbert is on his way. That's five. And yes, you're going with a six-man rotation, but your sixth guy needs to be that reliable mid-rotation type, a guy that can eat some innings, a guy that can give you 2.5 wins, maybe a little more. Maybe it's Taijuan Walker. So Williams would be more like, let's just add to the depth because you always need more than the five starters or more than the six starters. You're going to need 9 or 10 or 12 or 15 if you have a really bad year with injuries. But that just means, hey, if we don't have a spot for him, you have to be really careful what you pay him. So minor league deal absolutely makes sense because he might end up, you know, not making the club at all. So you have to be careful what you guarantee him. As for the non-protected Rule 5, you know what? There are some interesting names, but when I think about Seattle right now, I don't think any of those names have a legit chance to make any kind of impact, and I don't see Seattle housing a Rule 5 pick this season. You know, they may pick one or two and then kind of see what happens in spring training, but keeping that player up on the roster for a full season is going to be very, very difficult. Now, in 2020, they were committed to doing that with Johan Ramirez, but that was 2020. This is 2021. They're a little bit closer. They'd like to make the playoffs. They do have that as one of their top goals. But housing one of your 26 players that's a Rule 5 guy that probably doesn't have experience at the big league level at all, because Rule 5 guys rarely do. You're talking about a guy who's probably making a jump from A-ball or AA. So I used to really dig into the Rule 5. I hate the Rule 5. I think it should go away. I think minor league free agency should just come a little sooner. Because the whole idea of the Rule 5 is, you know, hey, let's not let one or two or five clubs like hoard talent. That's not fair to the players to just be blocked and to sit in the minors for 6 or 7 years. It's not fair. So if they're not on the 40-man roster, because if you're on the 40-man roster, you have a legitimate chance to see the big leagues. And that's what the 40-man roster is. That's the player pool for the big club. And while that's fluid all year long, if you're not on it, you're not getting up. So if you just bring minor league free agency to these players a little sooner, 1 or 2 years sooner, you take care of the Rule 5, and we can get rid of it and stop talking about it. So Seattle might take one or two and see what happens, and they certainly might take one in one of the minor league phases. But in the minor league phases, they're almost always irrelevant picks. We'll see how that develops over the next couple of years with a lot of things changing at the minor league level and certainly player development in Seattle, right? We're seeing things a little differently in player development right now with the Mariners. So maybe some of that changes in the way they handle the Rule 5, the minor league portion. But, man, I just wish they would get rid of it. I really, truly do wish they would just get rid of the Rule 5. Thanks, Chris. As always, Chris is a very busy Mariners fan. Busy Mariners fan. Chris gets it too, so have a lot of fun going back and forth with Chris on Twitter and certainly here on the podcast. All right, moving on. Lane in Tacoma asks, "Hey, with 2020 being a losing money in quotes for owners and numerous minor league teams looking like they will be left without parent clubs, are we closer to seeing expansion in Major League Baseball? Having minor league infrastructure already in place would be a huge hurdle to clear, and we know owners wouldn't pass up an opportunity to get a slice of the expansion fee pie." I don't think we're any closer than we were before the pandemic, because owners were already trying to cram an expansion solution through by continuing to explore and push and pressure terrible expansion ideas. I disagree with a lot of very smart people over this expansion idea in Major League Baseball. I think Portland is a terrible idea. Terrible. Awful idea. Portland couldn't support quite enough a AAA club. And while people want to say, well, they didn't move because they didn't get supported, I went to a lot of Portland games, man, and there were not many people in that ballpark. And people want to make the excuse that the ballpark was just built too large. I was there when there were 70 people in the stands, man. I was there when there were 400 people in the stands for a doubleheader. I was there on a Saturday night when there were 1,000 people in the stands maximum. And I was there on Fridays and Saturdays when there were only 500 people in the stands. And I'm not talking just in April when it's cold. That area did not support that team. Now, the area is a little different now. And people want to argue they support the Blazers. They support the Timbers. Like, there's more sports fans down there now. Baseball is a different animal. It is a different animal. It is long. Sports fans in general like baseball less than any other sport. We know this. I think Portland is an awful idea. Montreal is obviously an awful idea. No matter how much owners want to do it, there has to be a viable option or it fails and the league itself suffers, as does the value of the 30 clubs that exist right now. There has to be obvious and widespread support. They need a sweet stadium proposal and an approved plan by local governments. And until they strongly consider Austin and San Antonio, the league isn't looking in the right place. I talked about this before, I think over the summer. Austin, San Antonio area is the fastest growing metropolis in America. It's already larger than Portland. It's already larger than Seattle. Why are we talking about Portland and Montreal and Charlotte, which I actually don't hate the idea of Charlotte, and not Austin, San Antonio, just because there's already two teams in the state of Texas? Okay, so what? Texas is enormous. Why are we worried about this? But I think in general, expansion right now is a bad idea. I think the soonest we could see a new team is 5 years. I think soonest. But I think expansion in general is a bad idea right now. The talent pool is already watered down. And now the league has watered it down even more by eliminating athletes, by deleting minor league affiliates and draft rounds. MLB literally has no clue what they're doing. They've shot themselves in the foot on a consistent basis over the last 25 years. And it's getting worse. And they've been treating the league like a communications corporation for years, and it shows. So there needs to be, for, yes, you're right, Lane. They'd love to get a piece of that expansion pie because the fees are huge and they split that between the 30 teams evenly. But it's a one-time thing and it can damage your product. What if you put a team in Charlotte and it doesn't work? And when I mean doesn't work, like, I mean doesn't work like the Charlotte basketball team. Like, for 10 years or so, it was fine, and then all of a sudden you're like, whoops, how about the Vancouver Grizzlies in the NBA? And we're talking about a league in the NBA, or if you want to talk about expansion in the NFL, leagues that don't have problem generating interest in their product. Major League Baseball has a problem generating interest in their product, and now they want to generate interest in 31 or 32 clubs, because ultimately you can't have 31 teams. You need 30 or 32. And right now you have 30. If you want to expand, it needs to go to two spots, which makes it that much more difficult. So I think the earliest is 5 years. I think, yes, they'd like to cram it through. We're just not close to that right now. And the economy is just getting beaten to a pulp with the pandemic. And I think that pushed it back, if anything, because locally in states and counties and cities, things are not good. So I think MLB, I think the owners would approve something, but they need something to approve first. They need owners. They need widespread and obvious support. They need approved plans by local local governments right now. Might be like, if you're down in Portland right now, are you giving a darn about Major League Baseball? If you're the mayor, if you're county executives, if you're the governor of the state, no. You have so many other things to worry about, and it starts with the pandemic. You need to fix your general economy first before you pour a bunch of money in building a stadium for a Major League Baseball team that, you know, shoot, may not even last. May not even last. Thank you, Lane. MLB expansion is coming. I just don't know how soon. Like I said, I think it's at least 5 years off. I wouldn't be surprised if we got to 2030 before a team was playing. Would not be surprised at all. And I would actually prefer it personally. Appreciate it, Lane. Lane in Tacoma. That's where I'm from. Born and raised in Tacoma. Narrows League. Well, I don't want to call myself an athlete. I did play baseball. A little bit of basketball and a lot of baseball. But I'm not Bobby Moore or Ron Say, because that's the way it sounded when I said athlete, Narrows League athlete. But yeah, I'm a Tacoma guy. So welcome, Lane. Appreciate it. Kathy checks in with a really fun question about the Mariners advanced A level for 2021. Kathy asks, which players can we look forward to see playing for Everett this year? Hancock, Kirby, Carlson, Campbell, Williamson, Deloach, Marte. Also, which top prospects from other organizations might be playing in the new Northwest League? The last part of that question about other organizations, I'm going to have to get back to you. So let's have that conversation in like March. Because once this gets pushed through, we're probably going to learn that some affiliations have changed as well. Now, the Mariners' affiliation with Everett's not going to change, but we need to let this become official. So I can't really speak with a lot of confidence about the other organizations and their affiliations in the Northwest League, but it doesn't sound like there's going to be any change between Everett and Seattle, except it appears the Northwest League is going to become a 132-game full-season league for the Seattle Mariners and some other clubs. So normally they'd start that season in April. Maybe in 2021 that season starts in May because of what they might try to do in spring training. They might try to stagger where the major league player pool goes to spring training on normal time. And then once they leave in late March, the minor leaguers start. So the minor leaguers would get like 3 or 4 weeks. They'd get started like 3 or 4 weeks later than normal. So, but that's all right. You can still get in a 132-game season. You can still get in a 144-game season, which will be the AAA length, and the 138-game season at the AA level. You can still get those in by playing a little bit deeper into September. So Kathy is wondering about which prospects could see time in Everett in 2021. You know, like 3 months ago, we'd have been talking about which prospects might end up at Modesto in 2021, because essentially that's what Everett is going to be. They're going to be Modesto. Everett is better than Modesto. I was in Modesto. Modesto's terrible. Everett's not so terrible. But it's going to be a lot of fun to have not just the AAA club less than an hour away, but the high A club less than an hour away. There are advantages to that. And I think we have a question in the hopper, and we'll talk about a little bit more later in the week about what the advantages actually are. But I think the advantages to the AAA club being close are real and apparent and right there in front of us, clear and obvious. I think the advantages to having the high A club close gives the club another place to rehab a player, because I think that's when you really would like your own front office to be able to have a look. If you have a Yusei Kikuchi or a Marco Gonzalez or a Kyle Lewis, or somebody rolls an ankle and you want to rehab them, they miss 3 weeks, and you want to rehab them and not just toss them back into the lineup. Having a team close, having a second team really close, is a big advantage, because you'd rather not send that player on the road with the team. And what if, you know, if it's Marco Gonzalez, if the Tacoma Rainiers are in Memphis, you're not going to fly Marco Gonzalez all the way to Memphis if the Mariners are playing at home, or if the Mariners are playing in Oakland, or if the Mariners are playing in, you know, San Diego, right? Or Colorado, or almost anywhere else. You want it to be easy for not only Marco Gonzalez, but for the team and for anybody that the club wants to send to kind of monitor him and make sure that he's ready to roll. Now, you're generally going to trust your people, your player development staff, in those places. But there is an advantage to having a second affiliate really close, because if Tacoma's out of town, just send Marco Gonzalez to Everett. And you can do that even if Everett is on the road. What's the furthest they go? Boise? Eugene? It's not that far. So huge advantage when it comes to rehab stuff. We'll get deeper into that a little later in the week, in the second episode of this week. So Kathy's wondering which prospects could see time in Everett in 2021. And let's assume that we get a full schedule, or at least something close to a full schedule. But even if the minor league clubs don't get to start until May, I do think they can get their full schedules in again by playing a little deeper in September than usual. So I'm assuming we're going to get really close to a full schedule, which for Everett would be 132 games. I think there's a real chance we see Julio Rodriguez start the season in Everett, though there's also a real chance that he starts the season in AA Arkansas. The one thing we don't know, and the reason I'm 50-50 there, is because when we last saw Julio Rodriguez, he finished the season in Modesto at High A, but it was a couple of weeks. But that was also 2 years ago. What we don't know is how much did he develop over the last year? We don't know that. Only the Mariners know that. That's the crazy part about this time. I don't have a clue, really, where Julio Rodriguez is. He's somewhere between High A and Double A for me. So I wouldn't be surprised if they said, let's just send you to Everett. If you tear it up for a month, we'll send you to Arkansas right away. They could do that, or they could already feel really good about starting him in Double A because they'd like September at the big league level to be an option, and they certainly want to make sure he progresses enough up the chain to debut at the big league level in 2022. So I think there's a chance Julio Rodriguez sees Everett in 2021. It would be a relatively soft assignment for him if the Mariners really saw lots of development in 2020. The problem is he was hurt for a good portion of 2020 as well. So that clouds things up also. And I think, you know, that's another reason why Everett is in play, I think, for Julio Rodriguez. I think at some point in 2021, it seems sensible to think Brandon Williamson could see time in Everett, Isaiah Campbell, Emerson Hancock, Juan Thin, Zach DeLoach, Brian Perez, Matt Brash. How about Jose De Los Santos, who's a sleeper in the system? Among others, maybe Connor Phillips too, Carter Binns, Tyler Keenan, a draft pick from last year. I think there's an outside chance that Noel V. Marte gets there, but I'd be at least mildly surprised if he and Milcar Perez started there. We're talking about two prospects that, yes, they probably have bright futures, especially Marte, but they've only played in the DSL so far. They haven't even played stateside, really. I mean, Marte is obviously getting some pump down in the fall league in October, but that's it. So I would imagine they start in Modesto, if not down in the, you know, down in extended spring training. There's certainly a chance that a guy like Marte and certainly Milcar Perez and some of the younger guys start down in extended spring training and don't get sent out right away. That's a possibility as well. But again, like the Julio Rodriguez part of this conversation, I don't know exactly how much Noel V. Marte progressed. Now, he was healthy all of 2020, and they did keep him at shortstop down at the alternate training site at Cheney Stadium. And he worked with some far more advanced players than he, older players than he. Everett might be a little, I would be at least mildly surprised if he starts the year in Everett. I'd be more than mildly surprised. I'd be pretty surprised. I imagine he starts in Modesto, and we kind of go from there. But there's certainly a chance that he gets to Everett. I think Everett will be loaded. I think Arkansas will be loaded. I think Tacoma will be loaded. I think Modesto will be loaded. You know, Sam Carlson, if he's ready to roll right away in the spring, whether it's April or May, depending on the staggering and spring training and things like that, if he's ready to roll, I'm sending him to Modesto, letting him compete, and seeing what happens. And remember, Sam Carlson hasn't pitched much. He was a second round pick in 2017, pitched to a few batters, hasn't pitched competitively since. So wouldn't even be surprised if he stayed back and extended spring training, more for workload purposes. But I think his first action is going to be likely in Modesto. And but don't be surprised if he competes in the Arizona Rookie League first, because they want to monitor the innings. They want to monitor the competition, not ask him to do too much. But I think he probably sees both of those levels in 2021, both the Rookie League, because, again, he hasn't pitched, and Modesto. Now, again, I don't know how much he, you know, accomplished in 2020. I know he's healthy, and I know he's very well conditioned. He's an absolute beast, a great athlete. So maybe he's just ready to roll in Modesto from day one. As for Everett, might be a stretch for Carlson, but performance could dictate. I mean, if he just goes out there and looks like the first round talent that everybody thought he was in 2017, he could see Everett. All four of those full season affiliates are going to be absolutely lit with talent. And that's because the Mariners organization is absolutely lit with talent. So if you live near any of those, and I imagine a lot of you live near Tacoma and or Everett, but Modesto, Modesto's a fun ballpark to go to. Haven't been to the Arkansas ballpark. I've been to some Texas League ballparks, but never the Arkansas ballpark. But that team's going to be loaded as well. And I'm assuming there's going to be a minor league season. I'm still not 100% sure it happens. I'm hopeful. I think everybody's hopeful. I think we've learned a lot over the summer and certainly this fall and will more this winter. And with a vaccine coming and some potentially positive things happening when it comes to the pandemic, I think there's a decent chance we get not just Major League Baseball a full season, but minor league baseball a full season as well. I think they need to be a little more careful than they were last year. But again, I think the league and the players and coaches and the staffs of these organizations, Major League and minor league, I think we've all learned a lot and can take that into 2021. And if we do it right, we can do it. So I'm hopeful for that. Kathy, thank you. Hope all is well on the east side of the state. Good luck to the team in Cooperstown. Kathy's got a little league team potentially going to Cooperstown, which is very, very cool. I've heard about that before. A buddy of mine took his team to Cooperstown, and they loved it and said it was just an amazing experience. So hopefully Kathy and his Kathy and her son's team, they get to Cooperstown and have fun as well. All right. I wanted to close out this episode with some thoughts on how the market is developing and its effect on the Mariners' efforts, so to speak. And I think it's really all, it's either flat news or it's good news, because no starting pitcher has received more than 2 years yet. And that two-year deal, the 1 2-year deal, was for $9 million a year, and that was Mike Minor with the Kansas City Royals. Only one significant reliever, Trevor May, has signed. And we haven't seen a single meaningful position player sign yet. DJ LeMahieu's still out. I mean, everybody's still out there. It's not a great free agent market, but the guys at the top, they're all still out there. So the Mariners still have as much of an opportunity as they did when the offseason started. And we're a month into it. It's been very slow, starting to pick up a little bit. But the Mariners can, if they want to, try and swoop in and offer pre-pandemic values, which I'm just talking about market value last year, the year before, and maybe get a player they otherwise wouldn't. So that opportunity is still there. That has to please Jerry DePoto. That has to please the Seattle Mariners. The one problem with that is all the open dialogue and opportunity out there for these players is also still there. It's not like a bunch of big market clubs have filled positions. So while the market hasn't kind of shoved the Mariners out of what they want to do, and I don't expect that to happen, and if anything, it's opened up for maybe a few more possibilities that may otherwise not have been there. And we thought this was a possibility with, you know, teams wanting to be conservative because of the loss in revenues in 2020. But the player and agent here typically won't admit that they won't get a better deal this early. So there's an obstacle there as well. I don't want to say you're going to have to blow away some of these relievers or mid-rotation starters, but the agent and the player are going to have to be pretty convinced that that's the best they're going to be able to do. So if you want to be aggressive, you know, maybe now's the time. I'll use Jake Odorizzi because I've used him as an example quite a bit because he fits the mold. You get a mid-rotation type guy, fits somewhere behind Marco Gonzalez, probably in between Gonzalez and Sheffield Kikuchi. In this rotation, maybe he's the number two. Probably doesn't take anything more than 2 years. Might even prefer a one-year deal. And you might be able to get him for $8 to $12 million. Well, if you go to Odorizzi now and offer him $8 million, he probably says no because he's thinking, I can get more than that. Robbie Ray got more than that. Drew Smyly got more than that. I have a better track record than both of those guys. So if you're Seattle, maybe to get him now, you have to offer him more AAV and or maybe another year. Now, I'm not even saying Odorizzi can't get a three-year deal. But I'm just saying if you're wanting to get a guy like an Odorizzi that fits in the middle of a rotation that might even be your number two, you might have to offer a pre-pandemic value to that player, which in Odorizzi's case is probably at least 2 years and, you know, $22, $24 million. What would you think if Seattle signed Jake Odorizzi tomorrow for 2 years and $24 million? He's probably, you know, assuming he's healthy and he doesn't have any major injuries right now to worry about. What's he, 30, 31 years old? He's had some pretty good 150 to 180 innings, 180 inning seasons. He's, you know, that number three, number four type starter in a really good rotation. Again, he's probably a number two or at worst a number three in the Mariners rotation as it's currently constructed. I wouldn't hate that. I would see value in that. Now, maybe Seattle thinks they can get a similar player without giving up that second year, without going as high as 12 AAV. But I think that's where we sit right now in this market. And I think that's where the Mariners are. That's where their opportunity is. Because it's been slow, the opportunity is still there for something to pop that maybe otherwise wouldn't have been available to them. And this isn't really just about the Mariners being more willing to spend than other teams. This is maybe a player not wanting to wait any longer, not wanting to take the chance. If you throw out a two-year deal for Odorizzi, there's no guarantee another team gives him a two-year deal. Or if you give Odorizzi a three-year deal, there's no guarantee that another team goes 3 years. And it's going to be very difficult for a player like Odorizzi to turn down 2 years or 3 years from a team like Seattle if it's the only two- or three-year deal he gets. Like, that's how you make up the difference between can Odorizzi go to the Dodgers and be their number five and have a great chance to win the World Series? Well, if the Dodgers were interested, yes. But that's the problem. Maybe the Dodgers aren't even interested. And if they are, is it 1 year and $10 million versus 2 year and 24? Odorizzi's not 26 years old. He's 31. He can't be turning down too many more multi-year deals. He turned down multi-year deals before last season to accept the qualifying offer. There's no question he would have received multi-year deals, potentially including from the Twins, where he wanted to stay. So I think that's where Seattle is in the market right now. Because it's kind of later on the calendar, but it's still very early in the market. Very few players, as you know, have signed. Seattle can afford to sit back and kind of wait this out some more in terms of free agency. The arms that make the most sense are still out there. They're still out there. I don't think Drew Smyly, Robbie Ray, and even Trevor May were really all that high on Seattle's list for various reasons. Because maybe Seattle doesn't want to give a reliever 2 years in whatever Trevor May got. Top of the market money. And certainly Smyly and Robbie Ray are maybe a little more risky than Seattle wants to go with their big starting pitcher acquisition this winter. There's still a lot of rotation options out there. We talked about Odorizzi, Taiwan Walker. The trade market remains a distinct possibility as well, which is why you keep hearing me mention names like John Gray and Tyler Mahle and Zach Eflin. And I've actually heard the Mariners have asked about the price point on some low-risk, medium-reward veterans like Rick Porcello and Michael Wacha and Jake Arrieta. So it appears they're thinking about this the right way. Get the reliability, but don't rule out an upside play either. Like, it can't hurt to have, like, let's say they go out and they get Taiwan Walker or Jake Odorizzi, but they also sign Michael Wacha. It's not going to hurt to have that guy, that extra guy. You can do some things to make sure that guy gets starts. And then by the time Logan Gilbert comes up, maybe you're ready to trade one of those guys. Maybe you're ready to move Justin Dunn to the bullpen. So the fact that they're at least thinking that way, it certainly gives me additional confidence that they're looking at it the right way. Not that I had any doubt. Considering the market for Garrett Richards right now, by the way, you heard me talk about Richards a couple of weeks back about an ideal potential starter to bullpen transition guy. But considering the market for him right now, which looks to be 1 year and about $10 million, perhaps with incentives and perhaps with a second year option, I think my thought of pushing him to the pen and letting him dominate for 1 to 2 innings at a time isn't likely to be realistic this winter. And I'm not surprised, but he is ideal. I think Garrett Richards, the reliever, could be very, very good. And he was good as a starter last year. I just don't know how long he can, you know, hold on and hold up and stay off the injured list. Red starter Anthony Desclafani is another potential starter of the bullpen idea, but again, this market is probably going to hand him a 1 year deal for what, $5, $6, $7 million, maybe more. Maybe he gets Robbie Ray's contract. He's 31, was league average for what, 4 or 5 years in a row. He really struggled, you know, in 2020. If he takes, say, $4 million guaranteed with incentives for games started or finished, if he's moved to the bullpen, he could be a lot of fun in either role. But in these starter to bullpen transitions that we're thinking of, the player, they're free agents. They have to be on board with the transition. So with Garrett Richards, you're going to negotiate with him as a starter. With Desclafani, you're negotiating with him as a starter. Therefore, you're going to pay for him as a starter. So it doesn't look like that's going to come to fruition, even in this market. On the reliever market, keep names like, I know everybody wants the Trevor Mays of the world. You want to go out and get Liam Hendricks or Blake Trinan. I get that. And I'm not saying those guys are entirely out of the conversation. Well, I think Liam Hendricks is. I don't think Trinan is entirely out of the conversation. Keep in mind, Seattle needs legitimate, proven major league quality middle relievers too. Guys that can get three outs in the fifth inning once the starting pitcher is pulled because he couldn't get through the fifth. They don't have those guys either. So when I name a bunch of these names that I'm about to name, some of them you're going to be like, nah, don't do that. Seattle doesn't have guys this good yet. They have some young guys that could get there in a year or two, but they don't have it yet. And this is one way to raise the floor and raise the ceiling of your ball club and your bullpen. Guys like Pedro Baez, Steve Cishek, AJ Ramos, David Phelps, David Robertson, Jake McGee, Greg Holland, Justin Wilson, Mark Melanson, Jeremy Jeffress. Some of those guys aren't going to excite you at all, and I get it. But think about it a little longer. The Mariners do not have that right now. And I think at least half of them make sense, if not all of them make sense. And one of the roles Seattle has wide open in their bullpen, which is all of them. They don't have their long, their middle, or their high leverage sewn up. When you think about the Mariners' bullpen holdovers, 2020 to 2021, I can only think of two off the top of my head that are pretty much guaranteed roles to start 21. And that's Kendall Graveman and Anthony Mishevitz. And then the starter that doesn't break as part of the rotation, like a Nick Margavicius or an LJ Newsome, could serve as the long man. But I don't think anyone else is even close to a lock, including Johan Ramirez, Casey Sadler, Joey Gerber, Sam Delaplane, Wyatt Mills, Aaron Fletcher, Walker Lockett, Casey Sadler. I mentioned Casey Sadler already. Brandon Brennan. None of them are locks. None of them are making money, and none of them are locks. There isn't one legitimate high-leverage arm on their roster right now. You're hoping guys can continue to develop, to get better. You're hoping Ramirez can throw more strikes because the stuff is really good. You're hoping you can bide your time with one or two of these guys. But none of those arms, including Graveman and Mishevitz, are ready to be like a top three arm in a competitive bullpen. So the Mariners have room to add as many as four arms that will make the opening day roster. Now, some of you out there are like, yeah, what about Andres Munoz, the kid they got from the Padres? Well, they do hope he's going to return to the mound in 2021, but he had Tommy John surgery in March of 2020. And it's not automatic that Tommy John surgery recipients get back in a year. Sam Carlson had surgery in early July of 2018, and he wasn't ready to go until April of 2020. A date pushed back, obviously, again, because there was no minor league season this past year. So if Munoz does return in 2021, it could be the second half of the season. So Seattle isn't going to push it. And I bring up Munoz because the club isn't going to assume that he's going to pitch at all in 2021 when it comes to their roster decisions this winter. He's not part of the, well, we can rely on that guy plan. They cannot assume he's going to be available. If he is, great. You'll find time for him. No problem. And as for the left-handed bat the club reportedly wants to add, that player either has to be an outfielder or a multi-position player with at least second base or third base in his tool shed. We've talked about a lot of the possibilities here, including former Mariners infielder Brad Miller. Can play a little second, can play a little third, can play a little left field, can play shortstop if you needed him to, but he'd be your third. He only needs to be your third option behind starter J.P. Crawford and your number two option, Dylan Moore. So if you had an injury there and Crawford needed to go to the IL, Dylan Moore could play shortstop and Brad Miller can play second. And you can do the same thing with some of the other utility options out there. Because Dylan Moore is capable at shortstop, you don't need your multi-position player to be able to handle shortstop well enough to fill in for an injured J.P. Crawford. And that's always a concern about your bench. You need somebody else that can handle shortstop. Well, they already have that built in to their, who's probably going to be their starting second baseman, and Dylan Moore. Miller had a solid year as a part-time player for the Cardinals last year, so he is interesting. He can hit. He's a left-handed bat, so he fills the multi-position role, and he fills the left-handed bat role. Pretty good against right-handers. There have been some reports out there on Cole Calhoun being a potential interest to Seattle. He had a good year in Arizona, has 1 year and an option year left on his deal that guarantees him $10 million. I think that's $8 million in 21 and a $2 million buyout on a $9 million option for 2022. We've talked about Kike Hernandez, too, as a guy who can play second and a little outfield. As for pure outfielders, I like Brian Goodwin as an option. I like Adam Eaton as an option. We've talked about how competitive the market might be for some of the younger options like Jock Peterson and Yrieksen Profar, who probably want more guaranteed playing time than Seattle can offer. So we'll kind of see how that shakes out. And, of course, last week I talked about an outside-the-box way to add an arm like Blake Snell without giving up a top five prospect. And for me, the top five prospects are Kelnick, Rodriguez, Gilbert, Hancock, and Kirby in some order. You may want to add Noelvi Marte and or Cal Raleigh to that list as well. But that could also mean taking on a contract like Kevin Kiermaier and hoping he can serve as the lefty bat the club wants. He does hit right-handed pitching and play defense, and that's really all they're looking for right now. A kind of a stopgap to Jared Kelnick and like a capable backup for the three starters and a way to prevent Philip Irvin from facing tough right-handed pitchers all year. Tyler Naquin, Cleveland Indians, is another very interesting arm if the club wants a pure outfielder. Left-handed bat, not a lot of pop, but plays good defense. Lots of names out there in free agency. But again, I remind all of us, and I have to remind myself of this as well. Jerry Dipoto is probably going to make a trade or two that we didn't see coming. So much of the focus is on free agency that there are going to be trades this made by a lot of clubs that people do not see coming because they're so focused on just go spend money and get Trevor Bauer. Just go spend money and get Liam Hendricks. Just go spend money and get DJ LeMahieu. Well, they're going to be trades. There are clubs out there like the Colorado Rockies, maybe the Philadelphia Phillies. There are going to be probably 8 or 10 others that are going to be like, well, I got this guy and he's making money. You want him? And the trade Jerry Dipoto makes probably circumvents the free agent market and perhaps sets up the club to be able to do something a little extra. If you're out there and you make a trade for a player that isn't making $5 million, let's say one of the relievers Jerry acquires this winter is a player that's making $1 million. Well, maybe the player on the free agent market that they might have signed instead of making the trade was going to cost $3.5 million or $4 million. Or maybe they trade for a starter that's making $1 million that otherwise would have cost 10. Now all of a sudden you have $9 extra million that you wouldn't have had if you went out on the market and grabbed your Jake Odorizzi or Taiwan Walker. And again, if you're adding a mid-rotation starter, it does not cost one of your top prospects. It does not cost Noelvi Marte. It does not cost Jared Kelnick. It does not cost Emerson Hancock. It does not cost George Kirby. You can get mid-rotation starters, unless you're getting them for 5 or 6 years of control. You can get those guys without giving up your elite prospects. You absolutely can. And if Jerry makes a trade for one, they absolutely will get one without giving up your elite prospects. But what does that do? The advantage of that, the advantage of making a trade is you don't use your payroll flexibility. And, you know, while there is a lot of payroll flexibility in Seattle, you can kill it really quick with multi-year deals, multi-year deal acquisitions that don't help the club that much. That's a risk you take. Anytime a club spends money, it's a risk. And the key is how the front office mitigates that risk with backup plans and shorter deals and depth. And there will come a time pretty soon when it'll make a lot more sense for DePoto to take more risks, bigger risk, more risk. It will be warranted because the payoff will be winning 95 games, winning an American League West Division championship, contending for the World Series. That time has not yet come. We all know that. Maybe next year, heck, maybe at the deadline in 2021, Seattle does something for 2022 that's considered significant and adds to the payroll. In fact, I expect one deal at least between now and July 31 of 2021 that makes us go, huh. And that deal points to 2022 in a way most other moves they make this winter do not. In other words, it's just getting started and you should expect the unexpected. If there's one thing we've learned about Jerry DePoto, he's creative, which means unexpected. And I don't mean they're going to go out and grab another Jared Kelnick for an Edwin Diaz, Robinson Cano scenario. I mean, he's just simply going to do some things that we don't see coming. We know that. We know that's going to happen. And I expect that to happen between now and the trade deadline 2021. Would not be surprised if it happened in December or January. I wouldn't have been surprised if it happened in late October or November. I think 2022, while it's on Jerry's mind, they do have to think about 2021. It can't just be about 2022 this winter. It can't. You can't just simply go out and get guys that you think can help you in 2022. You've made a bit of a commitment now to the players, the city, the fan base, to do something in 2021, to do things this winter that help your 2021 ball club. And I am 100% convinced they're going to do that. They're not simply going to rely on all of the organic development. So I expect a fun December, I expect a fun January, and I expect a fun 2021 season, especially since 2020 wasn't nearly as bad as it probably should have been. All right, that's today's episode. Thanks to Baseball for Existing. Thank you, Steve Sandmeyer. Thank you to Chris, Lane, and Kathy for producing today's show. Be safe and smart, and never give up on a non-zero chance. Until next time, for those of you that are not subscribers and are listening to the free episode here, just head to bit.ly/getbtpod or go to baseballthingspod.com, click the link there, subscribe to the podcast, and get at least two of these every single week. Peace.